Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. As you look around the world today, you see poverty, you see children dying in the street, and you say, it's not my problem. My conscience is clear. I gave a few dollars here or there. Well, maybe you should read a book called Conscience, The Duty to Obey and the Duty to Disobey. It's written by my guest, Rabbi Harold Schulweis. It's published by Jewish Lights. Welcome, Rabbi Schulweis.
Thank you.
And it isn't just present day. You go back to the beginning of the Bible where God says to Abraham, take your son Isaac and sacrifice him. And as he goes up, God looks at him, and I said to you, does God have a conscience?
Well, in one sense, even though it sounds sort of anthropomorphic, I think God has a moral sensitivity. And it's that conscience which enables a real dialogue between the human and the divine. Because in the case of Abraham, when Abraham is informed by God that the whole city of Sodom and Gomorrah will be destroyed, his argument appeals to the conscience of God and says, how can you wipe out the innocent together with the guilty? Shall the judge of all the world not do justly? And God responds to that and says, all right, let's negotiate. That runs throughout the Bible, but especially in the rabbinic tradition, where one can appeal to God, even criticize God in the name of God for the sake of God.
There's also the story of King Saul, who did not kill his enemy, King Agab. And the prophet Samuel says, you're gonna lose your kingdom because you did not follow divine orders.
Right. And I think that this is one of the matters that the book deals with in general. We live in a culture that is so biased towards obedience and conformity that the critical ability to question a command has died out. And the point that I try to make is that certainly in Judaism, and as I think in religions in general, there has to be a balance between obedience and challenge. Nothing has the last word. And as I read the tradition, this is true even of the Bible. This is true of God's word, because there is a deep, intuitive, spiritual audacity in the human being, which encourages him to challenge the edict of pastor, priest, king, prince, everybody.
Ah, the courage to tell truth to power.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's correct.
But on the other hand, you have the people who are sheep, who do behave badly at the prison Abu Ghraib, and who will, as you show in that, what happened at the Stanford prison.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I think there were the two illustrations. One was the Zimbardo illustration of what happened in America with in Stanford with students who left to themselves without any kind of understanding became very, very cruel because they felt that was what was demanded of them. In general, people have been trained to listen to authority, even if that authority becomes authoritarian. What was the argument? Mm-hmm. Why did Nazism do so well? Why did communism do so well?
Well, Nazism, you have to say that by the time the ordinary German was told, kill these people. Hitler had diminished them as humans. They no longer were at school, they no longer were doctors. They were like animals to the average German. And it took a strong German, who was a pastor, Niebuhr, who said, I did nothing and then they would come
yes.
to me.
But I think that there's something a little bit more than Hitler. There is a culture of obeisance in mm-hmm. which you say you do not challenge. At the Nuremberg trials,
yeah.
what was it that all the people said to apologize, to justify their action?
I only followed orders.
We obey.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you follow the orders? And the answer that has to be given by, it seems to me, a religion especially, is to make room and to cultivate people who will say, no,
yeah.
I will not listen to that. And that you did have a number of people within the Christian community.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about Catholics and Protestants and peasants and priests who said, I will not listen to this.
Well, you list what is called a conspiracy of goodness.
Yes.
What is that?
Conspiracy of goodness means that in order to save, for example, Jews or anybody, when the enemy is pursuing you, requires a cooperation, a collaboration between lots of people.
Mm-hmm.
The illustrations that I give in one of the chapters is yeah. there's one great village, a Dutch village, in which everybody yeah. saved a hunted Jew, and nobody
yeah.
would betray it. So you couldn't find any betrayal. Everybody was yeah. involved. So it's a collaborative matter. If I want to save somebody, it is important that I have somebody else
yeah.
to share that kind of concern.
And yet you do mention various consuls, Mendes from Portugal.
Right.
Sugihara from Japan, who helped the Lithuanian Jews, who against what their governments were saying, issued letters that would allow the Jews to escape.
A remarkable story yeah. of heroism in which life and death was in the hands of somebody, a diplomat,
yeah.
who could write a passport or falsify a visa. These people lost everything, their property, their status, and so forth. This is the mystery of goodness,
yeah.
of altruism, of care, of concern, of sacrifice. This is something that I think has been and should be cultivated
mm-hmm.
in the churches, the synagogues, the mosque, but also this aspect of saying, if there is something that runs counter to your moral sensibilities, it is imperative, it is that you obey God by disobeying the edict.
You talk too about laws within the Bible, that because times change, the laws no longer can be upheld.